माय पार्टिसिपेंट्स, भारतीय विद्यापीठ इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ कंप्यूटर एप्लीकेशंस एंड मैनेजमेंट वेलकम्स यू टुडे टू द सेकंड सेशन ऑन रिसोर्स प्लानिंग इन मूडल. आर एक्सपर्ट फॉर दिस सेशन तान्या पाटेकर इज ऑलरेडी देयर विद अस. शी विल बी एनलाइटनिंग द हाउस ऑन रिसोर्स प्लानिंग थ्रू मूडल. सो मैम, आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू काइंडली स्टार्ट विद द सेशन.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So, good afternoon, all dear participants of the ongoing refresher course. I welcome you back to this 1 week long hands-on workshop on Moodle LMS. We began yesterday with the basic know-how of what a learning management system is, what are its components, what are the different flavors of a learning management system that are available, and how does Moodle suffice as the world's largest implemented and most favorable learning management system choice. So in the first session, I gave you a brief of all the theoretical attributes about a learning management system and Moodle in particular. Then later on, ahead in the day, we were walking through a guided installation of Moodle on-premise LMS. And I hope all of you must have been able to by now implement Moodle on your systems, on your workstations, or if not, you will be accessing our cloud-based version, for which Uttam sir must have shared the details with you. So that was the installation process till yesterday. Today, in the first half of the session, you would have visited how to create courses and categories in Moodle. What is the admin dashboard and how you create courses and categories in Moodle. So all the sessions are consecutively aligned in such a manner that every session is a succession of the previous session, and complete implementation of the previous session is important for the next session. So I will really request you all, if you are facing any problems or if you have not implemented what has been done till now, but to please do it by the end of the day and come up with doubts, because all sessions are going to be conducted in continuity. So let's move further. Today's session is on resource planning in Moodle. So I'll start. Okay. So as I mentioned yesterday, Moodle as a learning management system thrives on the basic concept of implementing distance education in the e-learning model using both means, synchronous as well as asynchronous learning. So this combined mix of synchronous and asynchronous learning mechanisms is more commonly known as blended learning, wherein in the synchronous mode, you and your learner, the facilitator and the learner, are present in the same virtual space at the same given point in time and are communicating to each other in real time. But the asynchronous learning mechanism is one wherein beyond the class, your learner wants to access certain resources, certain learning material, or you want to conduct some assignments or assessments of what has been taught in the class, that is conducted in the asynchronous mode. So Moodle as an LMS suffices for both the needs. As I mentioned, the heart and core of asynchronous learning, learning beyond the physical interaction or now the virtually simultaneous interaction, is known as asynchronous learning, and the heart and core of asynchronous learning is resources in Moodle. So resources basically are all data which you want to upload as a teacher, which you want to be present to the student for extended learning beyond your classroom. So we all have different kind of teaching aids using which we teach in our day-to-day regular processes. That can be PPTs, you want to give some notes as PDFs, you even have scanned images of handwritten notes, or you can want to be sharing some video links or URLs, external resources, some links to a NPTEL course or a Swayam course or some course on Coursera for which you want to suggest to your student, please take up this course as a prerequisite to my course, or please take up this course after learning the basics in my course as an advanced study. So there are different kinds of learning materials that we share with our students. How to emulate all those learning materials in the virtual space, how to bring in all those learning materials aligned properly in a learning management system, that is being done through resources and resource creation in Moodle. So today I'll be focusing upon what are different types of resources that are available for upload in Moodle. And then step by step, we'll be going about creating each type of resource. We'll be uploading different type of learning materials for extended study in Moodle. So let us start. So adding a resource or probably creating a course category, everything begins by installing the basic version of an on-premise Moodle LMS or by accessing a cloud-based service provider. Once you have your basic Moodle installation in place, the prerequisite to anything is creating a platform where your student comes and enrolls for study, and you as a teacher are present to disseminate knowledge. That platform, that common area where your student will come and get enrolled, is something called a course. So in the morning session, Uttam sir must have discussed with you how we create categories and courses. So just to give you a brief idea in layman terms, I'll detail out that concept because it is a prerequisite for creating resources. You cannot create resources until and unless you don't have courses created. Resources are only added to a course. Resources are extra elements or extended modules of study which are given within a course. So creating a course is a mandate. Before that, you cannot create a resource. So just to understand essentially, category is something like a higher level hierarchy or a broader term. When I say a category, just think of it to be something like a BTech program or an MCA program. So that is a category. Now, categories in a sense can have further subcategories. Your BTech program can have many specializations. It can have computer science engineering. It can have electronics and communication, IT, mechanical, so on and so forth. Similarly, an MCA course, an MCA program can also have many type of bifurcations. Like an MCA program can have 5 or 6 semesters, 4 semesters or a 6 semester program, 2 year or a 3 year program. So if we say MCA course as a category and further a subcategory to MCA course is semester one, then it is semester two. So this is the basic hierarchy that I'm trying to detail. What do you understand by categories and subcategories? Now, from subcategories, within the subcategory or even within a category, you can create a course. Essential is to have a course in place because a course will be a particular subject or a particular platform where the student will be coming and enrolling as a participant to the course, and you will be allocating teachers to that course as an admin. So I say if we have an MCA course, it is having 5 to 6 semesters. In first semester, in first category, subcategory, semester one, there can be different subjects. Say I have 5 subjects in MCA semester one, one of which is FIT, Fundamentals of Information Technology. Another one will be C programming. So FIT, C programming, Java programming, these are my actual courses. This is the area where you will enroll students. And this is the area where teachers will be allocated as designated subject matter experts. So creating a course is very essential. Once you have an MCA category within which the subcategory semester one, and then different courses. Now, every course will be possibly taught by a different teacher. Say if you have 5 subjects, you'll be having 5 teachers for those subjects. So this is where we bifurcate users in a Moodle LMS. We attach different users as teachers or allocate different users to different courses as teachers. So this is where everything begins. You need to have a course in place. So when we'll be doing the practical demonstration, we'll first be checking whether in our system we have courses created or not. Because until and unless you don't have a course created, you cannot add resources to a course. Now, if we understand the basic hierarchy of a course, let us understand what resources are. Now, say I have a course Java programming. Within the Java programming course, I can add different type of resources, and the resources of Java programming course will be different from that of C programming, right? So within Java programming, I can be giving PPTs for lecture dissemination. So I have different units. So I may have different PPTs or PowerPoint presentations which I want to upload. I will be having certain ebooks or notes in a scanned copy where I want to disseminate PDFs. So PDFs are another type of resource. I can also be doing my own manual video recording. I can be recording my video lectures and I want students to go through them. Or probably if I'm giving a lecture in a class and I say I'm recording that lecture and then I want to upload it on Moodle for further use for all those students who want to refer it beyond the classroom or have missed the class. So that kind of a resource is a video resource. So all these different resources will be added into a course, right? And different courses by by logic, they have separate type of resources. So this is the logical distinction between different terminologies in Moodle. And as I mentioned, resources can be of different type. Only and only prerequisite is to add a resource, you need to have a course. Now, coming to the different types of resources, first type of resource is a book. So Moodle gives you the advantage of uploading ebooks as PDFs, as any Word format files, anything like that, or even it gives you the flexibility of customizing and creating your own custom books. Now, if a teacher wants to create a custom book, imagine it to be a scenario if you've been teaching in a classroom-based environment, giving a lot of hard copy notes. You have your own notebook of algorithms or mathematical solutions, which you give students to get photocopied and further disseminate information in this. Then, in this case, slides are visible from my end, ma'am. Just let me know if others can see the slides. And if there is any issue in audio. Please just confirm if you can see the slides. Okay, thank you. Right, so imagine it to be a scenario where you have a lot of hard copy notes, say in a mathematical subject or in a subject where you're teaching algorithms or dry running programs, you want to disseminate some hard copy notes. How to do that in a virtual environment? How to do that with online classes going on? So you can create your own custom book, scan those notes and create a custom book out of it. Upload those book pages, upload the PDFs or the images in the form of a book. Now, it does not make sense that if I have a particular topic in math, say algebra, linear algebra, and I want to disseminate notes of linear algebra, there can be, say, 20 to 30 images, or it can be many PDF files, 5 to 6 PDF files. So independently, or segregating all those books and adding them independently into the Moodle LMS will create a lot of confusion. So you need a kind of a binding mechanism. You need to create a custom book. Okay, this is a book for linear algebra containing my scanned copy notes. So this is just to create a logical bifurcation where you can upload your own custom book formats, your own type of resources which you want to disseminate to the student. Now, the next type of a resource is very, very important in Moodle, that is called a file resource. If you want to independently upload a document, and the document can be of any type, it can be a PDF, it can be a picture, it can be a video or a sound file, or even an Excel sheet or a spreadsheet. So you want to independently upload a document, like I just want to give a lab assignment one for this lab. Suppose I'm conducting 2 labs in a week, and for one lab, I want to give lab assignment one, another lab, I want to give lab assignment two. And I don't want to give all lab assignments together. I want to slowly and slowly enroll those assignments to the. Bhuvneshwari ma'am, your mic has been unmuted. Please mute. Bhuvneshwari ma'am. Thank you so much. Okay, so if I want to give students lab assignments or upload single files as per my use, if I want to give a case study, so there is just one PDF file or one Word file that I want to give to my students. If I want to independently upload single documents within Moodle LMS as a resource, I will use the file type file, right? Next is folder. Folder is just an organizing utility, or a, you can say, component wherein you can add other type of resources. So if you want to group similar type of resources, like if I'm giving certain programs, I'm teaching C programming, and I have some programs which I want to give to the students so that they can download those programs when I'm teaching the topic and learn with me. I want to give some practical demonstrations beforehand. Then I can create a folder of, okay, this is for class one, these are your hands-on assignments or hands-on programs which I'll be discussing. So download these assignments and they form a combined utility. So I can upload them within a folder. You can upload any file type in Moodle. There is no restriction here. The next type of resource is an IMS content package. This is a very least used resource in Moodle because this basically suffices to the standards of uploading data in an LMS. So a content package is basically a file that contains content in database metadata. So when I say IMS package, so IMS is a body which helps technical standards to be defined for various things or resources that are uploaded in an e-learning model. So this is most widely used content packaging format, which was defined by IMS Global, and it uses XML file, or is also known as an IMS Excel, IMS manifest.xml file, to be uploaded to specify the standards, packaging standards for your Moodle resources to be uploaded. So if you want to provide this, and if you want to go into the technical nitty-gritties of providing content standard also specifically in an XML format, then you use this kind of a resource. Otherwise, this can be skipped. Yes, ma'am, you can provide ebook as a resource under, you can create a book. Within the book, you can upload the ebook as a PDF, or you can independently upload ebook as a file also. So I will be demonstrating all the resource types that I have mentioned right now. I'll be showing you how different resources are created in Moodle and how can you play around with the resource set that you have. So I'll be doing this in practical implementation also. You can create ebook resource. Okay. The next type of resource in Moodle is actually a label. So when your course gets very extensive and it's spanning over a semester, different types of resources are being uploaded into Moodle. There comes in a point where your resource page or your course page is very, very full of resources. There are too many resources that you have. If you want to provide labels for just logical bifurcation or giving some, you know, input to the student that, okay, I'm uploading five files, and beyond, beneath those five files, I can create a label or a heading sort of thing where I write, okay, this was the content of topic one. Below you'll find the content of topic two. So just to give a logical bifurcation, when your resources increase humongously in an LMS like Moodle, you can provide labels. So we'll be seeing how we create labels as well. The next type of a resource is a page. The only difference between a page and the file resource is that when you create a file resource, it will directly allow you to upload the file as it is. And the file will be viewed either in place, the Moodle utility, or in the software to which it belongs. You can change that setting. But when you upload a resource as a page, the resource gets embedded into an HTML page. So the page resource actually gives you the flexibility to add certain content above and beneath the resource, the file resource that you are adding. So if I want to create, a page resource, suppose I want to give students an assignment where I give them a video to watch, and based upon that video, I give them a case study to answer few questions. So first I have to give them the video. Either I upload the video or I give the URL of the video in the page. And then beneath the video, I want to specify some questions. Okay, based upon your understanding of this video or based upon your reading of the text from a particular PDF, answer the following questions. You can't do such a kind of thing in file source. It will just allow you to upload a video or upload the PDF file. But if you want to give certain additional content, you want to format it in the form of an HTML page. So this type of a functionality is available with page resource, where you can upload a resource and simultaneously beneath the resource or wherever, you can give the page description and content as well. You can further extend the document. So it becomes a kind of a custom document for the student. He gets the resource that you're trying to upload, plus your additional instructions. If you've given an assignment and you want to give certain instructions with the assignment, then you can do that using the page resource. The last type of resource available with Moodle is a URL. Now, there can be a scenario where you want to provide external URLs or uniform resource locators of resources being hosted over the internet. Suppose there is a YouTube video which I find very useful in continuation to the explanation of my concept. So I can provide the URL of that video as a resource on my Moodle page. So when the student will click that URL, the page will redirect the student to the YouTube video link and the video will start playing. Similarly, if there is an NPTEL course which I want the student to take up, I can give the URL of that NPTEL course or the Coursera course within my Moodle resource as a URL. So whenever you click on URL for a external resource, it will take you to the external application and the link will start playing there. So this is the URL kind of a resource. So with this, this was the basic of what is a resource, where is it relevant, or what are the different kind of resources that you can create in Moodle. Now let us move to the practical implementation of things. We will first start our Moodle servers, and one by one we'll see how we upload these different kind of resources within Moodle. So I request you all to please start your on-premise. If you have an on-premise installation, then start your XAMPP and log in into your Moodle site. If you are not able to download or install Moodle on-premise and you are accessing through the cloud version, then please log in into the cloud version by your credentials given by Uttam sir. Confirm in the chat box once you are done. Then I'll proceed further. You should be at this kind of a landing page. So this is my landing page for my on-premise implementation, where I've logged in using my username and credential. I'm on the dashboard. So if you are able to open your installation, if you are able to log in into your Moodle site, then please confirm in the chat box. Okay, great. Waiting for others. Yeah, I will proceed once everybody confirms, because it will be beneficial if we start from the same page. Otherwise, if we just miss one step in between, then further many steps will be very confusing for you. So please log in into your Moodle site, come to the dashboard, and confirm in the chat box. I'll wait for another 2-3 minutes and then we'll proceed. If you're not able to install Moodle, or if you're having still installation problems, then please log in into the cloud account or the cloud credentials that Uttam sir has shared. It's available on the group, WhatsApp group. Okay, so once you are able to log in into your Moodle account, this is the landing page. This is a dashboard that we were talking of yesterday. It's like the landing page for every user. It can vary whether you are your site administrator or you're logging in through the manager credentials or whatever. Your landing page will be the dashboard, and every user can customize this page. Now, first of all, before creating resources, we will check whether we have courses created in our Moodle site or not. So click on Site Home. In the left panel here, there is this option called Site Home. The sequence of this option can vary in your installation, so there is no problem. It's the second option for me. It can be the last or third, whatever option for you. But click on Site Home. Now within Site Home, when you click on Site Home, does not matter whether you have created categories or not. you can create courses even without creating categories. They will be added to the miscellaneous category or the default category of Moodle. But what is essential is that you need to have courses created. So whatever courses are available in your Moodle site will be listed on site home. So at least you should have one course. The name of your course can change depending upon whatever name you have kept. But at least you should have one course created here listed under available courses. So if you have one course showing up, any one course, just click on this course. I'm clicking on Java programming. You can click on any course of your choice. No problem there. When you click on this course, you land up to a course page, or this is called the how course is displayed, the display page of the course. Now, as a teacher or as a course creator, a site administrator, you have certain privileges to edit content into the course. I have installed an on-premise installation, so I'm the site administrator for my installation. So I have the super user privilege. If you have an on-premise installation, you will also be the admin user. Otherwise, even if you are a course creator or a manager, you can add content to your course. So this is how my course page will look. This is how it is displayed. But I want to add content. I want to update this page, or I want to edit resources within this page. So whenever you want to edit any settings within a course, click on Turn Editing On. There is this button towards the right side. It's called Turn Editing On. Click on Turn Editing On. The moment you see, you click on Turn Editing On, everything displayed on this page comes in an editable format. Like earlier, we were seeing only topic names. Now, beside the topic names, you can see some pencil signs, which means you can change the name of this topic. You can keep the name of this topic relevant to you. You can add or edit topics within the page if you want to add a section or edit a section, if you want to add a topic or edit a topic. So everything is coming in an editable mode. Now you are moved into designing from the display of the page. Earlier the page was there in a display mode. Now the page is open in a designing mode. You can change the contents of this page, right? So we can see there are four topics by default created within every course. You can rename those four topics, you can reduce those topics, you can add a topic, every feature is available. But what we want to do here essentially is we want to add resources to a topic. So with every topic, and this is the announcement section, with every topic in the announcement section, there is this plus sign and a link provided which says add an activity or a resource. Just click on this link. Add an activity or a resource. The moment you click on this link, there are three tabs which are available for you. One is all, second is activity, and third is resources. So all is actually a combination of activities and resources. Second tab is for activities. Activities is where students will participate, where you will do the assessments, create quizzes or examinations for the students, forums and surveys. Third tab is the resources. Resources are non-editable for the student. They can only be added by a teacher, and student can only view those resources. So there are different types of resources available. This is the third tab I'm hitting, and different types of resources available we have just now discussed in theory. In the slides, I discussed all these type of resources: book, file, folder, label, IMS content package, URL, and page. So different type of resources available with Moodle are listed here. It is as simple to create a resource in Moodle as we can see. So let us first start by creating a file resource, right? We'll click on file. In order to click add a file resource, you need to provide certain content. Now, this is a standard nomenclature across all Moodle pages, whether you have done installation or you're creating courses, categories, users, resources, anything. Whatever essential fields or whatever mandatory fields are there on a page will be marked with a red exclamation sign, right? So if we see here on this page, there is only one exclamation sign, which is called name. So this is the essential or mandatory field. The rest, all other fields are optional. We can or we may not give information within those fields. So now when I want to add a file, when I want to upload a file resource, let us first see how can we add a PPT, PowerPoint presentation, to a Moodle page. So I'll give this name. I'll say it is my presentation one, right? This is the name of the file resource that you're adding, presentation one. Description, you can give anything. You may or may not give description of this resource. I say I'll give there is description. Right. Now there are some editing options which are available on top of this description. Bold, italics, underline. Then you can add smileys, you can add images to the description text or audio files, record certain text, then alignment, bulleting, all these options are available. You may or may not want to indent or style your description, that's up to you. There is this checkbox which says display description on the course page. I don't want it to be selected because unnecessarily it is going to only increase content or data on the text page. So I don't want that happening. Next option here is select files. This is very important. You see this small icon on the top right which says add file. So you can either select this option and add the file using a file picker, or you can simply drag drop file from the folder and add it to this section here, this drag drop box here. So I'll say I'll add through the file picker. Now where is your file present? Your file is not present on the server. It's not a part of the Moodle data. You're going to upload the file. Click on upload a file. Choose file attachment. Navigate to the area where your file is going to be present. Suppose I want to upload the PPT of the session that I'm giving. You can upload any PowerPoint presentation. I have just selected one PowerPoint presentation of my choice. Navigate to any PowerPoint presentation present on your system. Click on open. You will see resources in Moodle.ppt. The file is being added here. That file has been picked up and chosen as an attachment. Now this way, if you just click on cross, the file will not be added. It's just been picked. The file picker has only picked the file from the location. If you want to upload the file, click on upload this file. The moment you do this, there is a PPT which comes under your drag and drop area. This PPT is the PPT that we selected, right? Now there are certain additional options, appearance related, how you want the appearance to be. You want the appearance to be embedded within your Moodle page. You want the PPT to be downloaded, forced download whenever the student clicks on it, or you want the PPT to be opened up in the Microsoft PPT PowerPoint application if you click on open, or you want to show it in a separate pop-up box. So I say let it be automatic. You want to show size of the PPT, you want to show type of the PPT, modification dates. You can check any option that you require. Common setting modules. How do you want the resource to be available? You want the resource to be visible on the course page, or you want to hide from the students? I say I want the resource to be visible on the course page. When will you want the resource to be hidden from the students? Suppose the teacher is preparing the course even before the course has started, or while teaching a particular course, I want to prepare for certain topics in advance. It is always the kind of scenario in teaching that we always prepare for minimum 2 to 3 topics in advance. If we are teaching topic 1, we will be prepared till topic 3 or 4. So this is the scenario where you want to hide from the students. If you're preparing in advance, you don't want the students to get confused by seeing this resource on their Moodle LMS page. You will initially hide it from the students, and later on when you have reached up till this topic, you are going to unhide or enable it for the student to view. So I say, okay, show it on the course page. I don't want to hide. If there is any ID number, if a resource or a PPT, you want to provide any customized ID number just for your reference, you can do that. If you want to restrict access, if you want to add any kind of restriction in the form of date or grade, if the student requires a particular grade in an assessment to view this PPT, then only the student shall proceed with this learning. Otherwise, first the student has to improve the grade. You want to control access on base of user profile, like students of only say morning batch need to see this PPT, evening batch do not need to see. So on and so forth. If you want to provide any restriction set, complex logic to restriction set, you can add restrictions. If you add no restrictions, it will just show none. Now, upon completion of the activity, if you want the students to mark the activity as completed, you must have seen this feature in certain courses, in online courses like Coursera or NPTEL. Whenever we take a course in Coursera, Udemy, or anything like that, your video marker or your video options, how many videos are available in the course, are present in a panel on, say, left side. And the moment you keep seeing a video, you keep navigating through the video, previous video gets ticked. It gets marked as seen. So if you want the student to actually mark the activity as completed, this is just for you to know how many students have completed this activity or how many students have viewed this resource. So if you want that kind of a completion marker, you can provide for that. You can say students can mark the activity to be completed. When you click on enable, it will ask you to set up an expected completion date and time. Like, say, I want to say till 31st October, the student should be marking this activity as complete. If the student marks beyond 31st October, then he'll be marked late. So that is just for gauging the performance of the student and how regular are they in their classroom activities. Next are tags. Now, if your course has certain tags or there are certain standard tags that you're using or certain hashtags, like if I say hashtag DBMS, this course, so this activity or resource belongs to hashtag DBMS. You want to provide any custom user defined tags, you can do that here in this text box. Competencies, if upon completion of this course, you want to mark student or you want to assess the student for certain competencies, you want to say, okay, this course has certain related objectives with it. After viewing this presentation, my course objective one should have been marked complete. So you can ask the student, okay, was it through? Do you need more assistance in that? Or you can manually grade the student according to your own satisfaction as well. Then you can use competency marking here. So I'm going to leave all this blank and simply say save and return to course. So you see here under topic one, there is this presentation one. If you click on presentation one, it gets downloaded as a PPT and it's opened up here, right? So this was adding a resource type file, and within the file resource, we added a presentation. Now let's click on add an activity or resource again. Go to resources, say file again. Now I say, I added a PowerPoint presentation. Now I want to add a PDF resource. I want to upload a PDF. Now this PDF can be anything. It can be a copy of the ebook. It can be your assignments. It can be anything in a PDF format. So I don't want a description. Choose a PDF. Upload file. Choose file. And I want to upload an exercise PDF. Save and return to course. This is how my PDF opens up here. So using the file resource, you can add any type of document, be it a PDF format or a PPT or even a Word file, independently under any topic in your course. Only thing necessary is that you need to have a course created, and within that course, you can add any type of resource that you like. Fine. So this was creating file resources or file type resource. Now let's move to the next type. Add an activity or resource. Resources. Let's create a folder. This folder is of my lab programs. I want to upload multiple programs within this folder. I want to skip the description. Don't want to give a description. Now, adding content to this folder is optional, which means either you can simply create a folder, later on go and add content or resources into the folder, or while creating the folder, you can add files at that same point in time. Both options are available with you. I'll say upload a file, choose file, I'll add certain programs to this list. I've added one file. Now, what if I want to add multiple files in this folder? One option is again click on choose file, choose another file type that you want to add, and one by one go on and adding files into this folder. Another option is, just a minute, I'll share this with you. Navigate to the location. Select the files that you want to add to the folder. Say I want to add three more files to the folder. Drag and drop those files to this location and drop it here. So you see simultaneously there are three more files which are added to this location, right? How do you want to display the contents of the folder? I want the folder to be clicked and I want it to navigate to a separate page. If there are any subfolders, I want to show those subfolders within the folder. Click on save and return to course. See, this is my lab programs. If you click on this, this will navigate to another page wherein you can see all file types that you have added. Now, these file types can be anything. I have added programming files. You can add PDF, Word files, any other programming file type or anything. So Moodle does not restrict you to a particular file type. You can add file types as and when, how many you require. Let's move back. So we have seen how we create a file resource, how we can add a PPT, PDF. Similarly, we can add a Word file also. How we can add a folder. Within the folder, we have a group of files that we want to upload. So these are the two types of resources. Within add activity resource, we have done file and we have done folder, right? Next type of resource that I will be demonstrating is label. So click on label. As I said, label is just a logical demarcation or a heading that I want to give. So I say the label text to be beginning of section 2, return. So after these three file types, there is a logical section. It cannot be clicked. It's just a label. It's just a text. So I've given it as a sort of a heading or a demarcation for the further resources that I'm going to add. You can always move these resources. You can always move the label or other resources and display them as and when you want. Then the next type is add an activity or a resource. Click on resources. We have done file. We have seen how folders work. We have seen labels. Next type of resource we will be adding is a page. Let's click on page. Now a page resource is where you can upload a resource and simultaneously with the resource you can give certain text of your liking, certain other comments or instructions from your end. I'll say this is a page resource. That's the name of the resource. Don't want to provide a description. Page content. Whatever content you provide here will be displayed as an HTML page. This is just the body of the HTML page that you can see. So I'll say start of page content. You can add any type of content in the page. You can link up files. You can add text, images, audio, video, anything. I say I want to insert or add an image. Where is this image found? You can either give the URL of a repository or you can browse for the image. Similarly, if you want to add an audio recording or a video recording, it can be done from here. I say I want to give a link. I want to give a link of an external file of a YouTube file. Navigate to the YouTube file, copy the link or have the link copied already. I have the link copied with me. You can copy it from the external source that you want to give and provide the link of this file, say insert media. So when I copy and paste this link here, it is going to be opened as a video within the same page. It is not going to navigate to the YouTube channel, right? And then I can give certain question based on your understanding. Answer the following questions. You can give your questions or whatever. Right? Click on save and return to course. Let's see page resource. So see, this is the start of the page content. Then you see, based on your understanding, give your questions here. And when you play this, the video will get played in place. It will not navigate to the YouTube channel. Right. So this is how you create a custom page or an HTML page, embed your resource within that page and give certain text according to your liking. Let's move back to our course page. Now we have seen how we create a file, folder, label, and a page. Next, we'll see how we create URLs. Click on URL resource. Give the name of the URL. I say external URL. I want to give an external URL of a video on YouTube. So either you choose a link, you browse for the link within your Moodle repository, or you copy the link from the external source and paste it here. Like I'm copying and pasting my external YouTube link. Now, when you are giving a URL, not just the name, but the external URL field is also mandatory, because whenever it is supposed to be clicked, it has to navigate to a separate location and open up a resource. So this is mandatory. Say save and return to course. Let's click on this URL. Now see, it has opened up YouTube. It's no longer there on my Moodle page. It has opened up YouTube because it is the URL of an external resource. So it will first open up that external resource in the application that you have copied it from, and then it will play it. So this is how URL work. You can simply click on back and you will be moving back to your course page. If you want to see how your page looks like, click on turn editing off. So this is how your page will be looking in the display view. Right now we were working in the editing view. We were adding content to this page. Now we are seeing how the page looks like in the display view, right? Your presentation, your PDF, label, folder, page, and URL. Now click again on turn editing on. And now we will create a book resource. Click on add an activity or a resource. You can do that under any topic. There is no restriction. Click on resources. Click on book. So when you want to create a book resource, the basic idea is you first create chapters. Only then can you create sub chapters within them. Now, if I say this is my book that I'm adding, the name of this book will be book resource. If you want to give a description of this resource on the course page, you can, or simply say save and return to course. Click on book resource. The moment you click on the book resource, it has no chapters added. So you've just created an empty book and now you're going to add chapters to that book. So you say create a chapter. First thing it will ask you will be to create a new chapter. Give a chapter title. I say chapter one. Now content is mandatory for every chapter. You can give content as simple text, or you can also attach images, insert or edit an image. Here you can give your image by browsing through the repository of whatever scanned notes you have, or you can provide just simple text, whatever you require in this book chapter to be. So if you have one book chapter and there you want to provide many scanned images, you can attach many image files from this browse repository. I'm just giving content as text and say save changes. So see, now when you see here, the book resource opens up with chapter one, and besides, in the right panel, there is table of contents which show chapter one. What are the chapters available? There is only chapter one available. If you want to edit the chapter after creating it, you can click on settings option. If you want to delete it, further delete option. You want to, that is visible right now, so the eye is coming like that. You want to hide the chapter, you will click on the eye, it will become hidden. Now, if I want to add another chapter, then there is this plus sign, chapter. Add a new chapter. Previous chapter will be chapter one. Name of the second chapter is chapter two. You can add it as a subchapter of chapter one or as the next chapter as well. So if you don't click on this checkbox, it will add it as the next chapter in the table of contents. Giving a dummy content and saying save changes. So here is chapter one and then we have chapter two. Let's see how we create a subchapter. Creation of subchapter is similar to that of a chapter. Only thing is we are going to attach it to the hierarchy of a chapter and not table of contents. So click on plus sign. Chapter title. Subchapter. Then click on this checkbox which says subchapter of chapter 2. This is subchapter 2.1. Text. Sample text. Save changes. So now if I see here, my table of contents says there is chapter 1, there is chapter 2, and there is subchapter 2.1, right? You can move back to your course page and you see here, now if you click on the book resource, it will lead you to chapter 1, chapter 2, and subchapter 2.1. You can navigate to any of the following, any of your liking. Right. So this is how we create basic resources within a course page, file resource, page resource, chapters, folders, URLs. So if you're facing any problem or if you have any doubts, please let me know. If you were able to perform certain resource creation with me simultaneously, please confirm in the chat box. If you have any doubts, please unmute yourself and ask. If you want a suggestion on how to extend the topic according to your use case, or you have a particular type of resource, you want to know how can you add that resource, you can please ask. Because that is the demonstration from my side. If you have any doubts, we can discuss further. Otherwise, that is all when it suffices to the practical portion.
Any participant has a kind of query related to this, they may kindly ask, ma'am. If you're trying to face a problem, you can even discuss that. If any participant ask a question, you may kindly ask.
Ma'am, is there any size restriction also? Like I was trying to upload a PPT and the error came that the size is too large.
Just a minute, ma'am. So here, when I try to add content, my file size comes unlimited.
Ma'am, I just tried on this cloud-based only. I chose a file. And like I was uploading that lecture 10. So now it has uploaded. Okay. Upload this file.
Yeah.
Error was coming. Now the error is the file lecture 10 PDF is too large. The maximum size you can upload is 2 MB. Okay. Probably I think I have, when I was making up my this, I had I think restricted it to 2 MB. Uttam sir told it to restrict it to 2 MB. Probably that is the reason.
Yeah, maybe because I did not restrict file size.
You did not restrict, but in the morning when we were doing, I think we have done the restriction that it should be 2 MB.
Then definitely, then
probably
definitely.
Yes. Okay.
So there are many options available with every resource type. You can use those options as per your convenience. If you want to mark completion tracking, if you want to mark competency assessment, or if you want to restrict for certain views based on groups, cohorts, or whatever user types, every type of restriction is there. So when I will be discussing in tomorrow's session, the first thing I'll be discussing is how to create users and what are the different user roles available. So we'll be first seeing what are the different user roles, user types, and then we'll be seeing how can we create a specific type of user and allocate a role to the user. So after that, the next step will be you'll be enrolling users as students and teachers into your course. That will be taken up by Uttam sir. So there you can, if you have certain users or if you have certain students enrolled in your course, you can provide restrictions on resources based on those users as well. So that will be continued tomorrow. So far, if anybody has a doubt or any extension point you want to discuss, please feel free.
If participants are confirm in case you are able to do it.
If you want me to repeat any resource creation, please let me know if you've missed out on anything. Okay, so the details of the cloud account created by Uttam sir and the steps given to log in is there on the WhatsApp group. So I will just highlight that text again on WhatsApp group. And if you face any problems, you can write there. Sir is also there. I'll also there. We'll help you. So I'll just highlight that on the WhatsApp group. I've shared the login credential information on WhatsApp. Uttam sir will also be extending on this in a while. So Khan sir, just for you, once you log in, I'll be repeating a certain steps that you will be required to create resources. Just follow these steps. You will be led to the basic page of resource creation, and then you can create resources of your type. Okay, so this is just for Dr. Khan sir.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, sir, once you log in into the cloud account using the credentials provided by Uttam sir, you'll be landing on a dashboard, on a basic user page, which every user lands up with once he or she logs in according to his or her own credentials. This is the same landing page for an on-premise implementation and as well as on the cloud implementation. Okay, this is called the dashboard. And if you can see, dashboard is being highlighted in the left panel, the first option. Now, to create resource, the resources are basically types of material or extended learning material that you want to provide to the student that the student can refer after he or she attends your class. So like if I want to upload certain PPTs or some PDFs, or I want to upload some YouTube lecture tutorials or anything, I'll upload resources. So the basic requirement to upload a resource is that you need to have a course in place, right? So you need to first create a course. Course is like the subject that you are teaching. And within that course, you will add resources or learning material according to the course. So how do we see how we create a course on a category was detailed by Uttam sir in the morning. So once you've created a course, click on Site Home.
Okay.
Second option here, and this can vary in sequence in any implementation, but just click on Site Home. The Site Home will elaborate a list of all courses which are available in your system. Like in my system, I have two courses, Java Programming and Fundamentals of IT. Now to create a course, it is not necessary that you need a category, right? You can have a category just to logically group a course, like this is a course, these two courses belong to semester one, subcategory of category MCA program. You can provide that hierarchy or you can even skip that hierarchy. You can simply create a course. If you simply create a course like Java Programming or Fundamentals of IT, they will be attached to the miscellaneous category. That is the default category within Moodle, right? So you just need to have a course that is mandatory. Categories can be optional. So if I have two courses created on my system, they'll be listed in under the available courses head here. You will have Fundamentals of IT and you will have Java Programming. You can have any course that you create. That will be listed here. But the base requirement is you should have at least one course listed on this page to add a resource, right?
Okay.
So if I click on, say, Java Programming. Okay, so I'll click on the other course because I've already created resources in Java Programming. So I'll click on Fundamentals of IT. This is how your course will look like when you first open it up. It will have four topics by default, a section for announcements. So this is the display section. This is the display mode of your page, how your page looks like. Now, what we want to do is we want to add certain elements to the course. We want to add resources to the course. So we'll move the course from display to an editing mode. For that, there is this blue button here on the right side. It's called Turn Editing On. Just click on this blue button. And now you see earlier, it was just displayed topic 1, 2, 3, and now everything comes in an editable format. Like there are pencil signs corresponding to topics and announcement, which means if you click on this pencil sign, you can edit the topic name. If you want to change the topic name, if you want to give, say, unit 1. And it is very self-explanatory. It says escape to cancel and enter when finished. So I write unit 1 and I press enter. So the name of the topic gets changed, right? So this is actually the editing view where you can change or add elements to this page. Now, to add an activity or a resource, there is this plus sign corresponding to every topic. You can increase these topics also. You can delete these topics also. Like if I click on edit, there's an option to edit the topic. There is an option to delete, hide, whatever. So you can increase or decrease according to your own wish. But if you want to add an activity or resource, click on this plus icon. First tab that it will show here will display list of all activities and all resources which are available in your system. Now, just the logical demarcation between activity and resource is that a student will participate in activities. Student will take part in activities and will you can assess the student, you can grade the student, you can check for the progress of a student using activities. So student is going to change the activity or add content or, you know, participate in an activity.
Yes.
And when you talk of a resource, a student can only view a resource. That is only being added by the teacher or a course creator, where a teacher or a course creator wants to provide certain extension points to classroom learning. If I want to upload my presentations, which I use as a teaching aid, or if I want to provide a copy of scanned notes or something like that, then I will click on the resources section, right? So yes, this is the area where teacher is going to add his or her content. So all type of resources that you want to add into the Moodle system will be listed under the resources section. Now, I'll just give you a brief of all resources. Say if I click on file, this is the basic type of resource, file resource. When I say you want to add a file resource, you can add anything as a file. You can add PDF, PPT, Word document, any resource which you want to individually upload on your LMS will be uploaded as a file type, okay, right? And this is a basic convention across Moodle that just all the fields that are mandatory will be marked with a red exclamation mark. Like here in this page, only the name of the resource is mandatory, right? If you don't add any content or if you don't add description, any extra or optional parameters, then also it will work. It will just create a resource without any content, just like a blank label. Only thing that is mandatory is the name. So if I give the name of the file, say file resource I want to add, what type of resource you want to add depends on what type of file you upload. So either you can drag drop the file here, list of files, set of files also, or you can simply say add. Your file is not present on the Moodle data. It's not present on the Moodle server. You want to upload it from a system. So you'll say upload a file and choose file type. This will lead you to a file picker or a file navigator's kind of an option where you can choose your file type, whichever file type you want to add. You want to add, say, your text file, PDF file, anything. I want to add a PPT, I can select a PPT from here. I want to add a PDF, I can add a PDF and select from here, right? Similarly for a Word file, any type of file, say, I'll upload a smaller PPT. Say resources in Moodle, I want to upload this PPT. So I just pick up this file from the file picker and this file gets selected here. I say click on upload file. So the file will come inside my file dialog box. This is the file that I want to upload. Simply say save and return to course. So here under topic 4, you have added a PPT.
Files.
In this, yeah. In the same way, you can add a PDF, you can add Word file, you can add any file of your choice. Now, the next type of resource here, apart from file, the basic resource is a folder. A folder is basically a grouping hierarchy. If you want to group certain type of files, you can create a folder. So you can either create an empty folder, or when you create a folder, when I click on folder resource, you can add certain files at that same point in time, right? So I say these are my lab programs and I want to add multiple files to this folder. So one option is one by one, I select and I add using the file picker, or I simply navigate to my folder from where I want to pick up my programs. And say, I want to select 5 files, drag and drop to this box. So all the files, 5 to 7 files that I want to add will be added in a logical grouping like a folder. Now, why do you need a logical segregation like a folder? Because everything you are adding onto the course page is being added consecutively, one beneath the another. Now, there can be a point in time where you have added too many resources or too many illogical resources are present under the head or under the same category. If you want to group it out, if you want to give a more logical segregation to your page so that the student doesn't get confused, then you can have this kind of a utility called a folder. So you upload to a folder and go back, click on lab program. So see, set of all files that I've uploaded are available under my folder. So this makes it very clear to us that Moodle does not restrict you on file type. It's not just about PPT, PDFs. You can add any of your specific programming type file, or you can even add a .python file, PY, or a C file, any file of that format. It will just simply upload the file, whichever format you choose, Excel sheet, spreadsheet, anything of that sort, right? So this is the resource type folder. Now, when I click again on add activity or a resource, go to resources tab, there is this section called a label. Now, label, just like we understand in development, is a simple heading. If I want to segregate different resources that I have added through a label, I want to say this is where my section 2 begins under unit 4 or topic 4. So it will. I'll just add a label. I can drag, drop, and reposition every resource that I'm adding. And this label will just be displayed as a heading or as a header, a logical demarcation that, all right, above this is section 1 and beneath this will be section 2. So whatever new resource or activity you will add beneath the label will come as a section 2 or as a separate heading, so that the student can get very clear. So it can be a scenario, we have different units or topics, and within different topics we have subtopics. So for topic 1, subtopic 1, we are adding certain resources, then we write subtopic 2 as a label, and then we give resources of subtopic 2, right? So this is the kind of logical demarcation that you can provide with labels. Then the next type of resource here is a page. So the only distinction between a file and a page is that file will simply upload the resource as you want to attach, but a page is going to create an HTML page out of that resource, which means your resource will be embedded, but at the same time, you can add certain text above and beneath the resource. So there can be a scenario, say I am uploading a PDF for a case study, or I want to give a video where I want the student to view the content and answer a few questions after he or she has witnessed the content. So I will create a page. I'll give the heading as page, compulsory. Now the page content is compulsory. It's mandatory. Rest in all other resources, description and content was optional. But since you're creating an HTML page, you need to have a body part. So this is mandatory. So you can give some sample text here. And I say I will be adding a resource. And once the student views the resource, he has to answer some questions that I want to give. So what type of a resource do I want to add? I say I want to insert. Just give me a minute. I want to insert some media, like I want to insert a video file. So it can be a video on YouTube. So I have copied the link of this video and I simply paste it here. If it is present inside your Moodle repository, you can click on browse repositories also. So I say it is a media and insert the media. So this is not going to navigate to the YouTube page. This is going to open the video in place, right in place where the page is created. So once I've set up the content, I say save and return to course. Let's click on this page. It will navigate to a separate page in Moodle. And you see here, this is my initial text. This is the video. If I start playing this video, it will play in place within the page. It will not navigate to the YouTube channel. And then whatever questions I want to ask to the student, I can do here. So this is the difference between a page and a file utility. Now, if I want this YouTube video to be embedded as an external resource, which means I want the Moodle page to navigate to the application which is parental to this resource, then I'll say add an activity resource, resources, URL. URL means unified resource locator. It can be navigated to any specific content on the web. So it will navigate to that content. I'll say URL here. Either choose a link from your Moodle repository if you have the data uploaded in your Moodle repository, in your Moodle data, else you can copy the link and paste it here. Say save and return to course. When you click on this URL now, unlike other resources, it is going to navigate to a third-party application. It's a YouTube video link, so it is going to navigate to the YouTube channel where the student will be witnessing the video on Java 8 streams tutorial, right? So this is how you embed external. This URL can be specific to an NPTEL course, to a Swayam course, to a Coursera course, anything of that sort. External URLs within a Moodle resource. Now the last type of an activity which is relevant for use is book. When I say I want to create a book, it means I'm giving the teacher the flexibility to create a custom book. Now the teacher can upload certain content. It can be in subjects like you have mathematical subjects or you have algorithmic subjects where you have a lot of calculations, and most probably you teach through the blackboard mechanism, or you have your notes kind of a diary which you give to the student for photocopy. How to perform that kind of a scenario within online or virtual teaching learning? So for that, you can have a scanned copy of all those notes. You can be creating a separate PDF file, or you can be sending it to the student. But then everything is very disseminated. Everything is very separate in nature. How do I put it at one platform? How do I tell my students that, okay, for unit 4, you need to refer to these specific note types, these specific PDF files or scanned images as notes for study. Now, one thing is that you create a simple file type, you upload those images or as you upload those texts as a folder or a separate file. But a more logical kind of an approach is that you create a custom book out of it. That, okay, this is chapter 1, to according to this unit, this is chapter 2, and so on and so forth. And you upload those scanned files or PDFs within your custom book, right? So for that, you create a resource type book. So we are creating a book. I'll write a simply book resource. When you first create a book resource, I've just given the name of the book. First thing that you have to do is create a chapter. A book has to have at least one chapter. One compulsory chapter has to be created. So give it a name, chapter one. Content is mandatory, because when the chapter will open up through the table of contents, something has to be there within. You can give random text. You can associate images, the scanned images that I was talking about, by clicking on this icon, browsing through your repository and uploading images. You can also restrict the size of the image. You can upload media, audio or video files, whichever you like. I'm just giving sample text here. Now, this is how the book looks like. Chapter 1, table of content tab on the right hand side, which says there is only one chapter. If I click on plus icon and I say I want to create another chapter, plus previous chapter will be chapter 1. I say chapter 2. If you check on this checkbox, it will create chapter 2 as a sub chapter of chapter 1. But I want it to be a separate chapter in the table of contents following chapter 1. So I will not check this checkbox. Just write some text, save changes. So now the table of contents is updated. Chapter 1, next chapter is chapter 2. You can rearrange. It can be possible you want to push up chapter 1 or you want to rearrange in hierarchy. You can do that here. If you've already created a chapter, you want to edit the contents, edit option, delete a chapter. By default, it is visible. If you want to hide it, you will click on this I symbol and click on hide again. What if I want to create certain sub chapters? So I'll say chapter 2, sub chapter, checkbox. Take the checkbox. So now the table of content looks like this. Chapter 1, chapter 2, and sub chapter. You can upload media also. You can upload images, text, all that kind of thing. Let's move back to our course. On editing off, this is how my resources look like. I can fit in these resources in separate topics. I can further add different types of files within these resources. So this is how you create resources in Moodle. Was it helpful, sir?
Yeah, very helpful, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Anybody else, if you have a question, if you want to discuss anything? The cloud account credentials will be shared by Uttam sir. I've highlighted the message and probably he'll be getting back on the group as well. If not, then probably we can close the session, ma'am.
Dear participants, if there are no more queries and you will want the session to be closed, kindly confirm so that we can then close the session. Fine, most of our participants are confirming. So in that case, I thank you, Tanya ma'am, for this wonderful session on resource sharing through Moodle. And that was a wonderful session. I hope my participants have made a maximum use out of it. The participants who have been trying themselves and or try themselves, kindly put in any doubts that you have in the sessions. So with this, I thank our speaker, Tanya ma'am, for the wonderful session. And ma'am, kindly accept this certificate from our side as a token of remembrance. I think it will take another minute to upload. So kindly bear with me.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yes. As a certificate token of remembrance, basically. So with this, we end today's session. Today's session, we have done resource planning and creation in Moodle LMS. I hope all our participants have maximized their learning from it. And with this, we end today's session. So thank you, Tanya ma'am, and thank you all my participants for being with us. We close curtains to today's session and we shall be joining again at the same time, at the same link tomorrow. So thank you so much. Manish sir, I think we can end the session now.